Hello and welcome to the WIHS Journal, Public Affairs from 104.9 FM. I'm Paul Kretschmer. Today we're going to meet a husband and wife team who fly Mission Aviation Ambulance Service in Papua New Guinea. Here they are to introduce themselves for today's WIHS Journal.
Yeah, hi, this is Mark Palm. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Samaritan Aviation.
Hi, I'm Kirsten Palm, his wife, and the mother of our three children, Sierra, Drake, and Nolan.
All right. How long has this ministry been underway then? When did it get started? And maybe after that you can tell us what the initial motivation or the thing that triggered you to both get involved in shepherding something like this to reality.
Yeah, you know, we first became a nonprofit in 2000, so we're getting ready to celebrate 20 years. But the original dream for me, just to give you a little background, I'm a third-generation aviator. My father was a minister, had a chance to work in with my parents, helping the homeless in Northern California as a teenager. And that had a big impact on my life, being able to serve somebody in the name of Jesus and not just tell them about Jesus, but do something tangible. And then I had a chance to go to Mexico as a 16-year-old and felt God speak to me down there after seeing a different culture and then the struggles that the rest of the world really lives it under. And the what he told me was very clear. He said, I want you to use your passion, Mark, for aviation and people to share my love in a remote part of the world. And that moment completely changed my life. And I know my wife has stories as well from going to Mexico and doing other things as a teenager.
Yeah, for me it was going to different mission trips to Mexico with my youth group as well. And then I went to university in Point Loma Nazarene University in San Diego. And I, at that point, was called to full-time ministry, but I didn't know what it looked like. And about a year and a half later is when I met Mark, and he had the plan of wanting to be a bush pilot, which is a very interesting story right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it was interesting to go back a little bit, and then I'll finish the story my wife was telling. But as a 19-year-old, I had a chance to go to Papua New Guinea for the first time, and with a friend of mine that was born over there. And we had a chance to live on the islands, remote islands with the people, and just really see what the needs of their life was and what it was like to live in this remote area. If you can picture a place, you know, most people in America don't even know where Papua New Guinea is, but it's in the north of Australia in the South Pacific. It's the second largest island in the world. It's got a fifth of the world's languages. It's considered the last frontier, you know, headhunters in the past. I mean, there's all this history there. Very remote area, and so having a chance to go there as a 19-year-old and really experience life, live in the bush houses with them, fish for my food, take baths in the ocean, and just talk to them about what life was like. And that's really where the vision for Samaritan came from, seeing this a need for access and hope for medical support and service, and then also seeing a need for a clear gospel message over there. And so coming back, meeting my wife in college, and then you know, having her have this call, and literally our first date, I said, hey Kirsten, you know, if you God's called me to do this in Papua New Guinea, and if you're okay with that, then we can date, and if you're not, we'll just have to be friends. And she was up for it, and that was kind of the start, a big start for our relationship.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
Not your normal dating, I don't think, for most
question.
People, but most questions that you get on your first date. But
no,
she,
that's for sure.
He was up for it.
Yeah, God had already prepared my heart, so.
It occurs to me that the average story of such a situation would be the man has this dream, and he's been praying on it, and he's been preparing for it, and then he meets the love of his life, and the first thing he does is shock her by saying, oh, say, did you know that I'm planning... eventually planning to go out to PNG and you know, you'll love it. It'll be great and all that kind of thing. And she's thinking, not really. I hadn't even thought of it, let alone whether I'd like it or not.
Yeah, I was very thankful that God had prepared my heart.
Yeah, so we came back from this trip in 94. We started Samaritan 2000, and then we spent 10 years going around the states, just telling the story, explaining, really being advocates for these people in New Guinea, trying to explain where it was, what the needs were. And after 10 years, finally in 2010, we arrived there. I'm an aircraft engineer as well as a pilot, and I put the plane back together in the capital with a bag of tools from a 40-foot container, and I flew it into WEWAC, where we live now, and we began operations. And my wife and our three kids arrived in WEWAC, and we've been there now. It'll be 10 years, celebrating 10 years in January, and it's been amazing to be over there offering access and hope on a river, you know, 700-mile river. We compare it to the Mississippi. It's about that size. Literally 220,000 people living along this river, and there's only one hospital for them to go to. And that one hospital is 1 to 3 to 4 days away by canoe and by road. We can do that same trip in about an hour and a half with a seaplane, and we can land anywhere on this river and save their lives. And when working with obstructed births with moms, sicknesses, malaria, tuberculosis, crocodile bites, tribal fighting, all kinds of different sicknesses. Polio just came back this last year in Papua New Guinea. And so working with World Health Organization to try to stop the polio outbreak that's been happening, and delivering medical supplies to 40 different aid posts. We've delivered 170,000 pounds of medicine and working with disaster relief. But it's been an amazing journey, not just for my wife and I and our kids, but for our whole staff now. You know, God's been growing the organization. We were over there by ourselves for the first 5 years, and now we have 3 pilots over there now, 2 new seaplanes in the country, a medical director, and we have a 3rd airplane that's getting ready to go. But it's been amazing to be over there and serve as a family, and I think that was always our passion. It wasn't to be my job over there or her job, but it was going to be a family service and a call, and to have our kids be part of that and grow up in it. It's been a really amazing journey for us.
Yeah, our kids have been able to be involved with the ministry in different areas, not only the community development side, being involved in getting to know people in the community through sports and just helping in the clinic. They go on medicine deliveries with us. My daughter comes with me to visit patients and the new babies in the hospital. And she works in a clinic 1 day a week to help with whatever they need, whether it's to fill medicine, meet with patients. So it's been a really exciting thing to be able to have our kids involved in what we're passionate about and called to do.
It wouldn't surprise me if you're raising the next generation of mission workers in whatever form that takes somewhere down the line, you know, not too many years from now, really.
Well, you're absolutely right. And, you know, if you can imagine, one of the things, you know, we bring these patients in. We've flown over 1,251 patients into this one hospital already. And you know, if you can imagine being picked up on the side of this river where there's no water, there's running water, clean water, there's no toilets other than a little bush outhouses. When we pick up the people there, they've never flown in an airplane. They've never even seen the ocean. They've never seen cars, a lot of them, and electricity. And so we bring these patients out of these remote communities, and then we have that team that works in the hospital, and that's where our kids are able to be involved. And we feed the people, we clothe them, we pray with them, we share Jesus with them, and that's our.
It sounds like a very
very obligation.
It sounds like
we don't charge for our flights, and so you know, it's an amazing picture, really, of God's grace. For us, we don't deserve it, but he provided a way.
For many of them,
go into these communities, not charging, in a culture where it's really a picture of God's grace, offering access and hope, and being able to share Jesus with those people. It's been an amazing journey for our family.
This was the first of 2 broadcasts with Mark and Kristen Palm about Mission Aviation ambulance service in Papua New Guinea. For further information, call us at 860-346-1049. That's 860-346-1049. The opinions expressed are those of the participants, not necessarily those of the staff or management of the station. I'm Paul Kretschmer on the WIHS Journal, public affairs from WIHS, Middletown.